Maybe they'll give me to you, I said. Make me your host body. No thanks. I don't want any more young female human hosts. Too weak, too emotional, their heads too filled up with... She broke off. I waited for her to say more, but she didn't. She just set her crutch and started walking with a determined, if painful, step. I fell in behind her. Too emotional? Their heads too filled up with... With what? Oh, come now. What else do you think little girl heads are filled with? So there's a lot of awesome walking and awesome talking, most of which I won't detail here. I've probably read half of the book out loud already. When suddenly the two of them are attacked once again by the leopard. Suddenly, an osprey flies down and attempts to scare off the cat. It's Marco, of course, but he isn't able to do much. Cassie morphs wolf, but that isn't much of a match for a leopard. Now, a wolf and a gorilla, that's more like it. And Cassie manages to keep the leopard at bay for Marco to morph for combat and scare the kitty off. It turns out the Animorphs have been looking for Cassie for a while now. Marco goes into the woods to demorph away from what he assumes is an uninfested girl, but while Cassie tries to convince Karen to play the part and not reveal she's a controller, Marco is revealed to be eavesdropping. The whole cycle of yerk as parasite versus human as predators thing starts all over again, but Marco is far, far less eager to chat, and realizes the only way out of this is to kill Karen. But Cassie pulls a bitch move. If Karen should die, then why shouldn't Marco's mother and Tom? Marco rolled his eyes. His opinions of me was obvious. It was okay. I agreed with him. I was a muddled, confused, foolish girl. I was sacrificing my friends. For what? I was selling out the entire human race. For what? One thing I've wondered while reading this book again is if Kay Applegate planned Cassie's character out to be alienating to other people, or if she looked back at the work she had already done and decided to make that a thing. Cassie is desperate to end the situation without any casualties, yerk or otherwise, and she makes one really daring, really stupid, really dramatic move. She presses her head against Karen's and allows the yerk to enter her own brain and make her a controller. Marco, fearing that the yerk may morph something to attack him, morphs Osprey again and flies off to get the others. Inside Cassie's head, the yerk, whose real name is Aftran, learns everything Cassie knows, and in exchange, Cassie gets to experience some of Aftran's memories, including gaining the ability of sight for the first time. She also learns that the reason Karen was infested was because she was the daughter of the owner of Unibank, which, according to my research, means Karen is either from Denmark, Haiti, or Ghana. Aftran keeps her feelings to herself. She morphs Osprey and flies up to get her surroundings, but instead of heading towards the city, she ends up just soaring, enjoying the ability of flight and the bird's superior eyes. Eventually, she spots a rescue party of controllers. If the controllers find Karen without a yerk, they'll kill her. If Aftran returns to Karen, either the Animorphs will kill her, or the yerks will punish her for going on an unauthorized mission and losing a yerk weapon. If she remains in Cassie, the Animorphs will either kill her or tie Cassie up and have Aftran die of Chondrona starvation. If she waits too long to make a decision, the Animorphs and controllers will cross paths, and there will be a bloody conflict. This is what we call a clusterfuck. Well, with her experiences with Cassie in mind, including examining her memories and personality to determine that she is a genuinely caring, if totally retarded, human being, Aftran returns to Karen's brain. "What are you planning on doing?" I asked. I looked up and realized that Karen's green eyes were filled with tears. Karen's tears, but they only flowed because Aftran, the yerk, was crying.
"You tell me what you think I should do," Karen said harshly, despite the tears. "Andalites, humans, there's no difference. You're both smug, moralizing, superior races. You both live in beautiful worlds. You have hands and eyes and the freedom to move about wherever you like. And you hate us for wanting all those same things. We can't help what we are any more than you can. We're born with eyes and hands and legs. You're born as what you are. Slugs, Karen cried. That's what you call us, isn't it? Slugs, like some wet, slimy thing crawling across the sidewalk after it rains. Something you step on and say, ew, gross. You're a yerk. I can't change that. You can't change it either. All you can do is make other creatures into slaves so that you can be more free. How can you justify making Karen a slave so that you can be free? It's wrong. I don't care if you're a human or Andalite or yerk. It's wrong. Karen looked at me and nodded. Yes, I know. Aftran manages to find a caterpillar and arranges a deal. She'll let Karen go and remain controller-free, meaning no more sight or mobility, but only if Cassie will become trapped in a caterpillar morph. Aftran will only accept her fate if Cassie shares it. And Cassie agrees. Then the book decides to change focus to a much more popular character, and now Jake is narrating. Marco manages to find the rest of them and gives them the lowdown, with Marco saying that they have no choice but to kill the Yerk. There's always a choice, Tobias said. I can't get mad at someone not wanting to take a life. I can't get mad at someone for thinking life is sacred. I just can't. Doesn't mean killing ain't fun, though. Yee-haw! Man, if only I had another comet! The Animorphs run headfirst into the Yerk rescue team, and there's some shooting and things get hairy. They finally find Karen and Caterpillar Cassie, but it's too late. She's already trapped in Morph. Karen tries to explain the situation, but the Animorphs are pissed, so Karen makes a break for it, only to run directly into the goddamn leopard. But then, in an out-of-nowhere moment that makes me applaud every time I read it, Marco shows up from nowhere in Gorilla Morph, grabs the leopard by the tail, and hurls it into the sun Team Rocket style. Remember when I said Marco and Cassie were total opposites? That's what makes this moment important. Cassie found herself trapped between two forces that wanted each other dead, and did everything in her power, including sacrificing her humanity, to accomplish something the Animorphs have failed to do up to this point. Make peace. While everyone else has been so concerned with destroying their enemies, Cassie is so far removed from the situation that she managed to approach it from a unique angle. And when she manages to win over the hearts and minds of the two most difficult people on either side, a Yerk soldier who is bought into the propaganda of her race, and an ally who will try to win this war in the quickest and most brutal way possible, it becomes clear that she has worth among the Animorphs after all. I guess sometimes you have to choose between smart, sane ruthlessness and totally stupid, insane hope, I said, not even realizing that I was speaking out loud. You can't just pick one and stick with it either. Each time it comes up, you have to try and make your best decision. Most of the time, I guess I would have to go with being smart and sane. But I don't want to live in a world where people don't try the stupid, crazy, hopeful thing sometimes. Karen returns to the controllers, and the Animorphs take Cassie, who soon cocoons herself. We then cut back to her narration as she emerges as a butterfly, from going to total blindness to seeing in vivid color, to experience what a Yerk feels when first taking a host. Back to Jake's narration, the rest of the Animorphs watch as she breaks free, though they treat it like some bittersweet funeral. When Axe ponders about the biology of the butterfly, he mentions that the metamorphosis is like a natural form of morphing, which is total horseshit. And yeah, it seems that Cassie's barn rests on a giant reset button, because this restarts the morphing clock, and Cassie is able to demorph back to her human form. Though, if it's natural morphing, shouldn't she demorph back into a caterpillar?
And to make this ending even more sappy, the wildlife clinic got a new sponsor! Hooray! From Unibank! Cassie's dad is rolling in some sweet Norwegian or Haitian or Ghanaian dollars now. With all of this, Cassie has once again seen the beauty in life. Her absence successfully explained to her parents, she decides to go to the mall with Rachel, where she happens to run into Karen, now yerk-free. And Cassie goes shopping. So, Rachel demanded, holding up two sweaters, which one do you like, the green or the red? I thought of Aftran, the enemy. I thought of her swimming blind in the yerk pool, with only her memories of a brighter world. She told me that humans live in paradise. She turned her back on paradise to make a small peace. Both, Rachel. And I like the blue, and the yellow, and that gross color over there, and the stripes. We live in paradise, Rachel, and we don't even know it. And we don't know when it might end. We'd have to be fools not to enjoy it while we can. So whip out your credit card, girl, because we're adding some color. You know, I got a feeling that Cassie is going to end up looking a lot like this guy. Post-book follow-up. This book more or less single-handedly justifies Cassie's existence in this series. A large part of its success has to do with its structure. It's incredibly minimalistic, with very little action or science fiction elements to explain, and just two characters for the majority of it. This allows for a lot of thought, a lot of discussion, and a lot of themes to be covered. It's a book of discovering new things about one's enemies, reflecting on decisions of the past, and deciding what to do with the future. Aftran slash Karen is my favorite Yerk character in the whole series, though Visor One will eventually give her a run for her money. Aftran is a nobody in the Yerk ranks, a blue-collar alien slug, a minor cog in the Yerk invasion. It's that position of having the least to lose and the most to learn that makes her discussions with Cassie so awesome. While Number 8 the Alien hinted at this, it's this book that confirms that Yerks are as complicated and gray as any other race or any other person. One detail I love is that we learn just how much propaganda is used with both the Yerks and the Andalites. It reminds me of Axe's statement back in Number 4 The Message, that Yerks sap the life from planets and move on. But when you see Aftran admire the beauty of Earth, you have to wonder the validity of that statement. After all, the only times we see anything like that is in Number 7 The Stranger, which might have been a fabrication of the Elemist, and Number 41 The Familiar, which might have been a fabrication by, whatever the fuck was going on in that book. I seriously only scratched the surface of the ideas and themes presented here. I could go on and on about it, and I'm sure I'll be referencing this book a lot in future reviews. It's amazingly written, in the top 5 for Animorphs in terms of prose. Fans hearken this as a highlight of the series, and for good reason, and it's by far the best Cassie-narrated book. I will admit, I almost want to drop this book a point for how sugary and perfect that ending was, but I guess I'll let Cassie get away with it right now, considering every time she does something big that doesn't involve microscopic aliens and buffaloes that turn into Chapman, she royally fucks the team over big time in future books. The butterfly thing makes no sense in any kind of scientific standpoint, but I'll give a pass this once. I give Animorphs number 19, The Departure, a 10 out of 10.
I'm lifting the mask from a local clown and feeling down like him. And I'm seeing the light in a station bar and traveling far and thin. And I'm sailing downstairs to the northern line, watching the shine of the shoes. And hearing trials of the people there, who's to care if they lose? Take a look, you may see me on the ground. For I am the parasite of this town. I take a look, you may see me in the dark. For I am the parasite who hangs from your